All right. Good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us. My name is Jessica Baggett, the External Communications Supervisor for the Washington State Department of Health. Today, you'll hear a brief update from each of our panelists, and then we'll move to Q&A. We are recording this telebriefing, and we will post and share the link as soon as it is available. So our panelists today are Bill Moss, Assistant Secretary with the Aging and Long-Term Support Administration for the Washington State Department of Social and Health Services. We also have Candace Goehring, Director for Residential Care Services, also with the Department of Social and Health Services, and Dr. Charissa Fotinos, Deputy Chief Medical Officer for the Washington State Healthcare Authority. For our Q&A, as mentioned in the media advisory, we will call on and unmute individual reporters who have submitted a question to ask prior to the start of the briefing. We will not be taking questions via the chat feature. We may not be able to get to everyone who has submitted a request, and we are prioritizing Washington State reporters. So at this time, I will go ahead and turn it over to Bill Moss to begin with opening remarks. Bill.
Thank you, and good morning. My name is Bill Moss, and I am the Assistant Secretary for the Department of Social and Health Services, Aging and Long-Term Support Administration. I'm also joined, as you heard, by Candy Goehring, who is the Director of the Residential Care Services Division within HALSA. By way of just context, our administration also administers the Adult Protective Services program across the state, where we conduct over 60,000, or receive rather 60,000 allegations of abuse, neglect, and exploitation each year. The Home and Community Services Division is another division within the HALSA administration that provides long-term care services for persons with disability and the elderly who may need those services in order to either live in a community residential setting, a nursing home, or in their own homes. Aging Washingtons have been especially vulnerable to COVID-19. According to the Department of Health, more than 90% of people who have died in our state after contracting the coronavirus have been over the age of 60. We have 201 licensed facilities. I've reported at least one positive case to our complaint resolution unit, which is a unit of folks that take in complaints from facilities and the public regarding our long-term care facilities. I do want to just take a second to thank all of our providers out there who are working very hard to help slow the spread of the virus and to keep people safe. Their work is very difficult, and they continue to charge ahead and appreciate everything that they do. I wanted to say a little bit about how we work and fit in with the Unified Command Group, as well as the DOH Area Command. The DSHS ALTA administration does have a long-term care incident command that connects with Unified Command and the Area Command. In fact, we take direction from them. We've been working alongside them and trying to get PPE to long-term care facilities. I will admit that's been a struggle through the month of March, but I think we're in a better place now in terms of distribution and the availability of PPE. Our administration has asked for and received multiple waivers from both CMS and the federal government, as well as state waivers that we needed to offer more flexibility in how we determine eligibility for services, how we pay for those services, and how those services are provided. One example of that would be for adult day health centers, who are congregate centers where people come and receive health check-ins, blood pressure checks, those kinds of things. We've been able to offer that service telephonically so that service could continue. That's just one example of several where we've pivoted to so that we can continue to serve individuals during this crisis. A couple of more notable waivers that we have received. We did receive waivers for training and certification requirements for home care aides and certified nurse assistants. This is an important part of keeping a viable workforce in place during the crisis and working with the various associations around making sure we have people to provide care where that care is needed. I do want to stress that all of the services that are provided through the Aging and Long-Term Support Administration have continued through the crisis. We're still doing assessments of the needs of individuals and authorizing services for those needs and getting services out to people, whether we're talking about in-home personal care or care in an adult family home, a nursing home, or an assisted living facility. services. Again, all of those services continue. At the beginning of the crisis, we and are still very focused on helping hospital discharge work. And we were able to, in March, work on the number of discharges besides, I believe, 560 or so. Our work around the one of the other things we did was provided rate increases for nursing homes to help offset the cost of overtime, staffing rate increases, and the cost of PPE for those folks. We're currently working on rate increases for all home, well, most, I won't say all, most home and community-based services as well, and hope to get those out next week. Residential Care Services is the division, and Candy will talk more about this, so I won't spend much time on it. But Residential Care Services is the division that's responsible for regulatory work and oversight of our long-term care facilities across Washington. They have been very focused on doing infection control surveys across the state. We are have done infection control surveys. We'll complete that in nursing homes today. We're very close to completing those surveys in assisted living. We've still got a fair number to do in adult family homes and supportive living programs. When those are completed, we will be pivoting to a more consultative and technical assistance role, and working with the Department of Health to provide as much assistance to facilities and practice around infection control as possible. The things that we are working on today in partnership with the Department of Health and Unified Command Group obviously is more available testing across all long-term care facilities, universal masking for all long-term care providers. This would include all of our facilities as well as our in-home providers of personal care. And we are talking about developing COVID specialized facilities to be able to allow for cohorting of residents that are positive for COVID in a facility, in a specific facility, which would we think is something that is necessary and we need to be looking at and moving forward. So I'm going to stop there and hand it over to Candy.
Hi, good morning, everyone. This is Candy Goehring. I'm the Director of Residential Care Services for the Aging and Long-Term Support Administration. And we are the division within DSHS that is responsible for the regulatory oversight of our long-term care facilities and agencies in Washington State. That includes nursing homes, assisted living facilities, adult family homes, enhanced service facilities, our ICFIID institutions, and supported living agencies. Since the outbreak of COVID on February 28th in our state and our first nursing home, RCS has modified our survey investigation and inspection procedures, and we've changed the priority of our survey and inspection work to be responsive to the needs of those residential providers with COVID. We've added new infection control and PPE inspections on site as well as off site evaluations for the a little over facilities and agencies that we regulate. We have, as Bill noted, now completed focused infection control surveys following CMS guidance to all of our nursing homes this week to ensure that they are practicing proper infection control techniques and doing everything they can to prevent the spread of COVID-19. We have suspended all of our non-emergency inspections to all of our facilities, again, in order to focus all of our resource and efforts on the infection control and reducing the transmission of COVID-19. Additionally, we know that getting enough PPE for facilities has been a challenge, but we believe we have turned a corner on getting more PPE out to our facilities. DSHS is working closely with the Department of Enterprise Services and local emergency management agencies to identify which facilities are in need of PPE. And earlier this week, we called all of our long-term care facilities and agencies to conduct a survey. And this survey is being used to inform those local emergency management agencies and Department of Health about the affected number of residents and facilities with COVID or suspected COVID, how many staff work in each of the buildings and the census of each of our facilities and agencies. This information is critical to allow those other state and local county resources to be able to be responsive to the facilities in their catchment areas. Thank you, and I'm gonna turn this back to Jessica now.
Perfect, thank you very much, Candy. Next we'll hear from Dr. Charissa Fotinos, and she'll talk a little bit about testing.
Medical officer at the healthcare authority. About a week ago, I was assigned as one of the point persons for the testing response for COVID-19 for the state of Washington, specifically as it relates to long-term care facilities. We are going to work towards the ability for long-term care facilities to be able to identify symptoms consistent with COVID, have rapid access to testing supplies, the ability for someone at that site to be able to collect that specimen, have that specimen get to the lab directly with a rapid turnaround time so results can be returned to either that care provider if it's a long-term care facility or that person's provider facility staff so they know whether or not to be concerned about a potential outbreak. There are a number of things that to date have stood in the way of that ready flow of testing and information. One has already been mentioned, and that's personal protective equipment. In order to collect the specimens, at a minimum, surgical mask, a face shield, and gowns as well as gloves are required. Now that the testing is able to accommodate nasal swabs as opposed to nasopharyngeal swabs, which are a little bit more invasive for the person being tested, that will lessen some of the infection risk to people obtaining the specimen and will also help reduce the need for PPE, which is good. So there's one piece, and as the PPE supply sample expands, that will sort of take that roadblock out of the loop for testing. Some of the other challenges with scaling up testing to date have included the shortage of swabs, different types of collection parts of the body, whether it be nasal or nasal pharyngeal, require different swabs. There's been a shortage of swabs nationally and internationally. The state has come to acquire swabs, so that should be less of a roadblock going forward. The other piece that has been in short supply required for testing is the viral transport media. That has been also in short supply nationally and internationally, and there is a company now in Washington and Spokane that is helping to make that media, so that shortage should be lessened as well. So now that we have the ability to better provide the test kits that can collect the swabs, the next step in the process is taking the specimen to the lab. There are a number of labs that can do multiple COVID tests daily. We have a capacity in Washington right now of just shy of 14,000 tests a day. But one of the challenges the labs are now facing is some of the extraction material that they need to run the tests for their particular machines has also been in short supply. We don't know exactly how much of an issue that is, but we're asking the labs if they perceive that to be a problem or anticipate that to be a problem. So that's sort of been the supply side of what's hindered some of the lab collection. And when I'm talking about labs right now, I'm referring to testing for the virus. You'll hear it called RT-PCR, reverse transcriptase polymerase chain reaction. But essentially, that's looking for signs of infection. What the virus tells us is that somebody has been exposed to the virus. We don't yet have enough sophistication to know if someone who tests positive for the virus and doesn't have symptoms consistent with COVID, whether or not they're actively infectious or not. But in the setting of long-term care facilities, we want to proceed as if that person is infectious and do the precautions necessary to protect them, other staff, and residents from spread if that is in fact the case. So testing supplies are becoming more available, some limitation at the lab. The other piece is that we have, you know, part of our strategy is to make as readily available as possible all of the tests that need to be done in a facility. If there is a case of COVID that is confirmed in a facility or one that is suspected, the local health jurisdiction will go on site to that facility, assisted by the Department of Health Infection Control team, to determine how many people, including residents and staff in that facility, should be tested. Certainly, if they feel that every staff member and every resident of that entire facility should be tested, That's absolutely fine. There are some settings where there might be a long-term care facility that has a locked ward and a more freely mobile ward. Staff don't cross between those two. And so it may not make sense to test everyone in terms of staff and residents in that facility because they don't interact. But really, those decisions are best left up to the local health professionals from the jurisdiction that are there to determine what makes the most sense in that setting. And the other piece we want to try and build into this is we want to assure that tests turn around rapidly, but we would like to also help support the facilities in helping to recognize early signs of infection so that if there is a slowness in labs turning around, that there is a potential alert that there might be an infection happening because the symptoms are not always consistent in people who are older. So I'll stop there in terms of describing where we're headed and some of the current limitations that we have been up against in terms of broad testing, but those should be continuing to improve over time.
Great. Thank you to all of our panelists. We will start taking questions now. We will call on and unmute each reporter. To make sure that we can hear you, please use a headset if you have one or speak directly into the microphone on your phone or computer. Our first question today comes from Hannah Scott with Cairo Radio. Hannah, you are unmuted.
Hi, thank you. This is for anyone who can answer this. We had the emergency order that was signed by the governor that suggested that there might be some ability to move patients if they were to separate patients, positive from negative COVID patients, into separate facilities. Is that something that's happening or being looked at?
So this is Bill. We are looking at developing COVID specific facilities, meaning we have facilities that are only serving residents who are tested positive with the virus. That is not happening today, but we expect we'll be getting there very soon.
Great. Our next question today comes from Ariel Dreher with the Spokesman Review. Ariel, your line should be unmuted.
My question is, again, probably for anyone who can answer that. How are long-term care facilities or some of these retirement communities that maybe don't staff, a lot of medical staff, supposed to communicate and coordinate with local health districts when it comes to if a person needs to be transferred to a hospital for care? Sort of who's making that determination?
So this is Candy Goehring with Residential Care Services. Each facility for each resident will know who that person's primary care provider is. So their first call when someone has a change in well-being or if they have evidence of COVID should be contacting either the medical director of the nursing home or in some instances an assisted living facility. And certainly in the adult family home care setting or supported living, contacting the primary care provider. That primary care provider can then give orders and direction for follow-up care for that individual. We're also guiding our facilities to contact the local health jurisdiction, as Charissa mentioned, so that jurisdiction also can mobilize resources in terms of testing, PPE, or other kinds of support that facility will need. The determination whether to transport someone certainly can be made by that facility. So if someone is in need of emergency care and has a deteriorating condition, they would simply call 911 and emergency medical responders would make the determination whether to transfer someone immediately to a hospital. So there's multiple resources for a healthcare facility or a long-term care facility to use to get emergency care for their residents.
Great, thank you. Our next question today comes from Josephine Peterson with the Tacoma News Tribune. Josephine, you are unmuted.
Hi there. Yes, I had a quick question about what is that process for when a case is reported positive at a long-term care facility? How is that case reported? Is it first gone? Does it first go to a local health department and then get fed up to the state? And what paperwork needs to be filed so that there is record that there is a positive case at each of these facilities?
This is Candy Goehring with Residential Care Services. All of the long-term care facilities and agencies that we regulate have to report to Residential Care Services through a unit that is called the Complaint Resolution Unit, and it is our intake unit that we have. So whenever they have an infectious disease, whether it's influenza, norovirus, or COVID, they have to provide a facility report to the department that specifies what the infectious disease is, how many residents are affected, and what other actions they're taking. So that is recorded in our intake system. It is then processed and assigned to a complaint investigator for review and follow-up. And in these cases, all of the reported COVID, positive COVID or suspected COVID, are what we categorize as immediate jeopardy complaints, and we respond to those within 48 hours with both off-site and on-site activity, an inspector going out, and also doing, as I said, some off-site review if that's appropriate. The facilities should also be following all of their local, county, city, or other municipality codes and requirements for reporting. So that would include a report to their local health jurisdiction and completing whatever forms, online or paper documentation, needs to be made for reporting infectious disease.
This is Charissa Fotinos. I would just add the last piece of that is all the laboratories in the state of Washington have direct feeds for positive infectious disease required reporting right now, includes COVID, that the Department of Health would receive.
Thank you. Our next question today comes from Deborah Horn with Cairo 7. Deborah, you are unmuted.
Thank you. As you know, family members have been devastated, horrified, and a whole host of other raw emotions over what has been happening in these long-term care facilities and nursing homes. What confidence can they have, based on what you're now doing, that their relatives are safe and can be treated well in the facilities they happen to reside in?
Well, I was going to say, Deborah, that as I said, we have redirected all of our resource that we have at Residential Care Services to do those on-site and off-site inspections and review of all of their infection control practices and disease prevention, prevention of transmission of COVID. And through that process, we're making observations of care being provided. We're interviewing staff, we're reviewing policies and procedures, and we're providing consultation and technical assistance if we see an area of improvement or a gap or a break in infection control practices. And when and only when we see immediate jeopardy that might happen because of a break in a practice, we will cite that facility, which will require a plan of correction, and then we revisit to see if that serious concern has been remedied. So we as a regulatory authority are doing all we can to assure families and residents and the community, that their loved ones, their family members, their friends are as safe as they can be. But as we know, this COVID has spread rapidly, in especially our older adult population.
Our next question today comes from Megan Carroll with CREM 2. Megan, you are unmuted.
Thank you. Good morning. My question is for Dr. Fotinos. I was wondering if you might be able to share more about the viral transport media company in Spokane that's helping to alleviate the shortage of testing supplies.
I will have to get back with you through Jessica about that company's name. Off the top of my head, I don't recall it, but can certainly work to get more information out.
Okay, sounds good. I will definitely follow up with Dr. Fotinos and with you as well, Megan. Our next question today comes from Patrick Quinn with Como. Patrick, you are unmuted.
So you guys mentioned that at this point, there's about 200 facilities who have reported at least one positive case of COVID. I think when I checked back on April 6th, that number was around 137. So it's certainly going up consistently. Can you just talk about the trend of the infection rate you're seeing within long-term care facilities? Do you have reason to believe things are leveling off, like potentially we're seeing out in the normal world right now? Or can you just give us a sense of, since that first case on February 28th in Kirkland to where we are now, how we're trending?
So this is Candy Goehring with Residential Care Services. We run a nightly report from our complaint resolution unit and to see what facilities have newly reported, what facilities have updated reports that they have sent previously. And so that's where we run that nightly surveillance or facility report from. I don't have the trending or tracking data in front of me. I can tell you that while the individual number of facilities has continued to grow, we are seeing fewer reports than we did a couple of weeks ago. So we're continuing to get refinements from facilities when they report to us, but overall, we've seen a gradual decline in new facilities reporting COVID.
And our final question today comes from Amy Radel with KUOW. Amy, you are unmuted.
Hi, thank you. I just wondered if you could provide an update about Life Care Center of Richland, which sounded like they had a pretty significant outbreak.
Hi, this is Candy Goehring. I don't have any current information on Life Care Richland with me right now. I don't know the status of that building.
Thank you, Candy. So that concludes our briefing for today. Thank you again for joining us. If your question was not answered, you can follow up with us via email at WAJIC, that's WAJIC, at mil.wa.gov. Our next briefing will be Tuesday afternoon at 2:30, and we will send out a media advisory early next week announcing the topic and speakers. Thank you and have a great day.